Good afternoon, students. I welcome back for this teleconferencing session, and I welcome Professor Naval Kishore for another teleconferencing session, which is going to take place on shipment of export cargo. So under this topic, Professor Naval Kishore will deliver on shipping services and on chartering practices, the quality control, that is the methods of quality control, and finally the procedure of export cargo and documentation. Dear students, one thing which I want to make it clear, that in case where you want to make this session very interesting and very interacting, you will have to come forward. You will have to ask the question so that you can update your knowledge, you can enrich your knowledge. See, this is up to you how interesting, how active you are, how focused you are. In case if you are not active, if you are not focused, in that case the deliberation going to take place will simply defeat the purpose and will be a futile exercise. Therefore, it is my kind request to all of you is that you should have a very big benefit out of this session, and you should be very active for that. So for that, I welcome Professor Kishore to take over this session and to make this session more interacting and more interesting. Professor Kishore.
Thank you, Dr. Sunil. And again, I join Dr. Sunil to extend my very warm welcome to all the participants. After the trade, accounting and finance, this third session is devoted to the procedure of shipment, that is, shipment of export cargo. You all know that whenever you are exporting any commodities or goods outside the country, there is a procedure involved in that how the things should move from your doorstep to the doorstep of the buyer. So there is a whole range of procedures which are involved in this process. For example, when you have manufactured the goods, the first thing is packing of the goods. The moment packing comes, containerization comes into the picture. What is containerization? Containerization refers to the unitization, that is, there is a packet, there is a container. In that container you need to stuff the goods so that it facilitates the movement of the goods from one place to other place. So in the containerization format, there is a container, and in that container you need to stuff the goods so that it could move any hazards free or problems free movement, or there should not be any obstacles in the movement of goods, so that you put the goods into a container. Now this container has become very important in the international movement of the goods. Now, what are the benefits or what are the features of this containerization? So the first benefit of the containerization is speed and economy of handling. Once you are stuffing the goods into a container, now it can move hassle-free from one place to other place, because it can withstand the trauma, the problems of the movement of the goods and service goods, or the forces which are being imposed on the goods while moving. It can easily sustain that force once the goods are inside the container. Then economy of handling. Now in lieu of handling the bundle of the goods, in lieu of handling the packet of the goods, now what you are doing, you are handling the goods in a container. So it becomes easy for you to handle the goods or to make the goods move from one place to other place. So therefore, in the both the term, that is the speed, it can go in a larger speed, or there is a economy of handling, that means the whole container is being handled together. Next is your safety, both with regard to breakage and pilferage. Friends, as you must have noticed that whenever goods are being transported from one place to other place, there are lot of problems associated with that goods. For example, on the way it may break, on the way there may be some leakage in the, if there is, for example, while is there, there may be the leakage. For example, if there is a gems and jewelry or there is a textile cloth, it may get break, there is a glass, it may get broken. So what happens, once you stuff the goods into one container, now the container is a different size of the container, and in that container you are in the different things, you are stuffing in such a way that it is well packed inside the container. So on the way it may not break, or there may not be the pilferage in that system of the container. Third is your greater efficiency due to less rehandling of individual packages. See, whenever you are sending in a bundle, then in a bundle one manual handling is required in a bundle. But when all the number of bundles, number of packages are stuffed into one container, in that case what happens, the rehandling becomes quite easier, because the whole container is moving from road, rail, to ship and to the buyer's place. So in that case it becomes quite efficient for making the move in the container than that of making the move of the individual package, bundles, etc. Next is your less packaging cost. As I said to you that now you are making a bundle, you are putting that bundle inside the container. So now whenever lot of numbers of bundles are being put inside the container, in that case what happens, the cost, that is packaging cost, gets drastically reduced, because the upper packing and all that are not, that much is not required, because now those things would be taken care by the container itself. Next is less cost of insurance and handling. You know that you are stuffing in the container, so therefore the cost of the insurance and handling gets reduced, because one container you can put number of bundles, number of packages in one container itself, because the size of the container is a standard size and it is known to you. So the based on the size of the container, you put the goods inside the container. Therefore the handling from putting the goods from one place to others becomes easier for you, and the insurance also, the cost of insurance also gets reduced. Next is your door-to-door transport service. See, container, once you hire a container, once you get the container, stuff the goods inside the container, now that container can be brought into the doorstep of the sender, that is of the seller. Now seller stuffs the goods inside the container, now the same container can move to the doorstep of your buyer. So it provides you door-to-door services. Next is your packaging. Now packaging, there are two major or important philosophy or principles in the area of the packaging. One is the packaging must be strong enough, and the second is it must be light enough. See, both are the opposite concept, because once stronger it may be the heavier also. But you have to see while packaging that the packaging must be strong enough to withhold the rigor of the journey. Because you know in the journey there is a force, as a result of that force and jerk the goods may get damaged. So therefore the upper portion of the packing must be strong enough. But once you are planning to be strong enough, it also involves cost. So in that case, when it involves cost, you have to think you have to take into the consideration that it should be the light enough so that it withstand the rigor, at the same time it incurs less cost, because ultimately you as a sender, as a shipper or as a exporter, you must take into the consideration that the total cost on the packaging should not be very high. So you need to manage, or you need to put the cost at the reasonable level. As a result, what happens, you have to think over both the areas together, that if the packaging must be strong enough to just withstand the rigor of the journey. On the other hand, it must be light enough so that the cost should not increase much higher. Next is your marking and labeling. What happens in the area of the marking and labeling? When you are stuffing the goods inside the container, then there may be the number of bundles, number of packages, number of bales, so on and so forth. Now, the size of the container may be the larger one. So, which bundle or which package requires to be removed from one place to other place, or which place? In order to identify those bundles, those packages easily, what you do, you mark those packages and those bundles. Marking helps in identification of the bundles at the proper place. Because whenever you are offloading, whenever you are removing the goods from the container or from the ship outside the port, in that case, marking helps you in identifying the particular bundles or particular package of the goods. Second is your labeling of goods. What happens? Yeah, besides the identification, marking also helps you. For example, sometimes you want to tell the third party that keep that goods away from the sunlight or away from the rainwater, or in case of glass, suppose you are want to give the instruction that handle one side only. So if you handle opposite side, if you lift from the opposite side, what happen, it may get broken. So in order to avoid those things, you are marking the upper side of the package of your bundles or packet, so that whatever instructions are being given third party, they are supposed or they are expected to follow that marking symbol, and they are expected to follow that symbol so that the goods travel safe. Second is labeling of goods. See, labeling refers, sometimes you buy some of the goods of a standard company, then if you see inside of that goods, there may be a label, and in that label it may be mentioned that was at 20 degrees centigrade, or do not iron at home, or it is laundry wash, it is dry wash, or whatever instructions are given, you need to follow those instructions. That is called as labeling of the, it is usually in the garments, clothes. If you see the back side of the cloth, then it may be written that this much components of the terry cotton, this much component of the cotton, so it should be washed at this much of the degrees centigrade, it should be dried at this much, it should be a dry wash, it should be a wet wash. Whatever instructions are being given, you need to follow that instruction. This is called labeling of the goods. Now, after the packaging, marking and labeling of the goods, there is another area that is called nature of the export cargo. Now, export cargo may be primarily of three types. One is your rush cargo. In the rush cargo, what happens? Speed is the most important component of the rush cargo. Here what happens, for example, there are flowers. Flowers speed is the most important, because the per unit value of the flower depends on the base value of the flower. That means how much time it is away from the cutting of the flowers to the consumers of the fruit, to reaching the flowers in the hand of the consumers. So that is called base value. So here ras cargo, that is speed is most important, flowers are there, then you have vegetables, you have raw things. These are the things which where speed is most important, because if it is not maintained, it may get waste on the way. Second types of the cargo is known as the bulk cargo. In the bulk cargo, what happens, usually this cargo is the large quantity. That means you are sending in a very, very large quantity. Second is, such cargo demand does not change frequently. See, for example, you see the food items. For the food items, the demand won't change frequently, whereas for the fashion item, the demand may change very, very frequently. So in such sort of cargo, the demand does not change frequently. It is free from the product development. See, in some of the area, for example, textiles, for example, luxury commodity, what happens, it is new product keeps on coming into the market. For example, fashion garments. Every time you go to the market, you may find some sort of new fashion garments in the market, which may be different than that of your earlier one. So therefore, it is a continuous process of innovation and product development in fashionable garments. But whereas you see the food items, you might not find that much new product coming into the food items. So the chances are very less in the new product in the food items, whereas the chances are very, very high in the fashion garments or any other usable areas. Next is your low unit cost. So the per unit cost of such items are very, very less, whereas the per unit cost in the fashion garments, gems and jewelry may be very, very high. So because the quantity is more, so the per unit cost is very less in the bulk cargo. Next feature of this cargo is your transported and warehoused at lower cost. The because see, the single commodity in a large quantity, so the transportation cost may be very lower than that of the fashion garments and etc. And warehoused also at a lower cost, because you need not have a very, very sophisticated type of warehouse for the bulk cargo. Therefore, the cost of warehouse is very less in the area of the bulk cargo. Examples are primary commodities, iron ore, food grains, etc. Next is your general cargo. Third one is your general cargo. General cargo involves manufactured, semi-manufactured, processed and semi-processed goods. For example, goods basically which have you add value on that goods, that is called manufactured items. So from raw materials, you convert it into the value added items. So these are the examples of the general cargo. In such cargo, there is a fast change in demand. Demand changes very fast. For example, as I gave you the example that fashion garments, immediately you go to the next shop, maybe after some times you go the same shop, you may find different varieties of the goods there. Luxurious commodities, automobiles, scooter, motorcycle, usually these are the area where the requirement demand keep on changing, and considering the change demand, you product different products. Next is your higher unit cost. Per unit cost of general cargo is higher than that of your per unit cost in the bulk cargo. Next, again, higher per unit transportation and warehouse cost, because it requires a different equipment for the transportation. It is not one single way of the transporting the goods, rather there may be different compartmentalization, so that this sort of garments or materials maybe travel, or some ethnic sort of materials or some sort of traditional sort of material, those things transportation, warehousing may be quite expensive. Examples are engineering goods, leather products, textiles, drugs, etc. Now, after the nature of the cargo, next is your shipping services. There are primarily two types of shipping services. One is your liner shipping services, another is your tramp shipping services. You need to analyze the features of both the shipping services. Let us first analyze the liner shipping services and features of the liner shipping services. First feature is variety of cargo. In the liner shipping services, you may export number of cargoes. For example, there may be some garments, there may be some items of showpiece items, there may be some engineering commodity, there may be some leather goods. So a variety of cargo being stuffed in under the liner shipping services. Because a variety of cargo is being put in the liner shipping services, the equipments, machinery which are being used in the liner shipping services, that you have quite sophisticated instruments, machinery, etc. So there are varied and sophisticated instruments, machinery fitted in the liner shipping services. Why varied machinery shipped in the liner shipping services? Because what happens here, you need different varieties of cargoes to be taken care of, and the requirement of the rigor in different varieties of cargo may differ. For example, if it is a glass, then the rigor would be much higher. So in that case, you need the sophisticated instrument to carry the glass from one place to other place. So you have varied and sophisticated instruments fitted in the liner shipping services. Then least possible time in the port. Liner shipping services, it does not stay more time in a particular port. It stays very least time in a particular place. Next, operates regularly between the ports. What happens in the liner shipping services? This sort of services are the regular services between the ports, between the identified port, between the declared ports. It keeps on operating. Then sophisticated and expensive propelling machinery. See, not only the inside instruments, rather it is fitted with the sophisticated and expensive propelling machinery so that rigor or forces, outside forces, should not be very high, which could damage the goods inside the liner shipping. Next is pre-announced scheduled services. In the liner shipping services, whatever, the services are already pre-announced. It is being announced and in well in advance, you know that this services is being made available to you from this port to that port, from this port to that port, from this place to that place. It is well in advance announced by the liner shipping services, because you know there are many cargoes are involved in the liner shipping services. So it carries, it keeps, or it takes the cargoes from different places. So therefore, the scheduled services being announced so that the exporters, they know well in advance that they are going to ship particularly this product into this shipping services. Next, not negotiable. See, the terms and conditions in the liner shipping services are not negotiable. Next, fixed and stable freight rate. In the liner shipping services, the freight rate is fixed and moreover it is stable. It won't change, it won't be negotiable, it won't provide any scope for the changes. Next is your tramp shipping services. Just in opposition to the liner shipping services, the tramp shipping services, there are homogeneous cargo in the tramp shipping services. For example, the cargo of iron ore, maybe some metals, maybe some food grains. These are the homogeneous cargo which are being carried by the tramp shipping services. Well, because it has homogeneous cargo, that is one variety of cargo being stuffed in the transshipping services, the equipments which are fitted in the transshipping services, that is simple equipment. Why it is simple equipment? Because, for example, if there is a wheat, so only you need to dump the wheat inside the container. So when you need to dump inside the ship, so obviously it won't be different mechanism or not involved in that, because only wheat or only iron ore or the only one type of the product being stuffed in the ship, that is called transshipping services. Therefore, the equipment which are fitted here, those equipments are very simple equipment. As a result, the cost, that is low unit value of commodities carried. The commodities which are carried in the transshipping services, that requires low unit value of the commodity. Per unit value of the commodity is less than that of per unit value of textiles, gems and jewelry, leather, etc. Lowest possible cost. The cost involved in such sort of shipping services is the lower one than that of the liner shipping services, because there you have sophisticated equipment, you have sophisticated products, etc. Here you have one variety of the products and it is not required sophisticated instruments and all that. Therefore, the cost is lower side. Loading and the discharging are confined. See, in contrast to the liner shipping services, the loading and unloading are confined to a, because see, it is not a quite regular sort of transportation mechanism. So the loading and unloading are confined in the specified port only. Wherever, whatever ports are specified for the loading and unloading, it can be loaded and unloaded only at that particular point. The number of loading and unloading is not at every point. Does not have a fixed route and predetermined schedule. Like you read, you understood in the liner shipping services, in the liner area it had the predetermined schedule and route, but in the case of tramp shipping services it does not have a fixed route and predetermined schedule. It may be scheduled based on the requirement of or demand of the commodity or the demand of the movement of the commodity, but it is not predetermined. Terms and conditions are not fixed. Here, the terms and conditions may be negotiable. Depending upon the requirement of the shipping services, the terms and condition of the tramp shipping services may be negotiable. They are not fixed. Now, after you have already hired the tramp shipping services, the second thing is chartering practices. The ship can be chartered on based on three. There are three major chartering practices based on which you can charter a ship. The first one is called voyage charter. As the name suggests, the focus is on the number of voyage, on the number of sailing on the sea. So it is called voyage charter, and it may be the single voyage, it may be the consecutive voyage, or it may be the round voyage. Single voyage means from A port to B port. Consecutive voyage means from A port to B port to C port to D port, whereas round voyage means from A port to B port, from B port to A port. So either you may go for the single voyage, for the consecutive voyage, or for the round voyage. Now the features of this voyage is, first, agreed quantity of cargo from named port. It carries whatever agreed quantity has been agreed from one port to other port. In such sort of voyage, the ship owners meet all expenses of running the ship, officers and crew wages, stores and provisions, insurance of ship, depreciation, operating expenses like fuel cost, port charges, light dues, etc. All these expenses are being borne by the ship owners. Let us go to the next. After the voyage charges, the second type of the chartering practices is time charter. As the name suggests, here the focus is not on the voyage, on the trip. Here the focus is on the time. So therefore, this charter, this ship is hired for the fixed time period. 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, whatever time period is required, the ship is hired for a fixed time period. In the time charter, defined territories or between ports, the ship runs between the defined territory or between the ports. Already agreement takes place about what are the territories where it moves. For example, can it move in Asian region itself, only in the European regions, or from Asian port to European port, whatever the named port is there. So therefore, the time charter ship runs in the defined territories or defined ports. Here what happens, the charterers is responsible for scheduling the ship's employment, meeting port expenses, canal dues, fuel cost, cargo expenses, etc. That means these are the costs which are borne by the charterers, that means ship's employment, port expenses, canal dues, fuel cost, and cargo expenses, etc., are being borne by the charterers. Whereas the running costs are being borne by the ship owners. Running costs like you have officers and crews, wages, stores, provisions, insurance, etc. These are the running costs which are being borne by the ship owners. Here what happens, charterers can either operate themselves or sublet the vessel on voyage charter. Look, important feature of this, because the charterers hire the ship based on the time period. For example, charterers hire for 1 year, for 2 years. Now, in this circumstances, the charterer can also sublet the vessel. And if the prices, if the freight goes higher, charterer may earn profit out of this subletting the ship. Expenditure wise, the charterers have greater responsibility under the time charter compared to the voyage charter. What happens? Expenditure wise, the charterers have greater responsibility under time charter, then obviously, because here the charterers have to bear all these things, therefore charterers have the greater responsibility. At the same time, charterers can also sublet the thing. The third form of the chartering practice is bare boat charter or charter by demise. In the bare boat charter or charter by demise, what happens, the ship is being let out for a period of time, but it is a bare ship. It is let out for the period of time, but it is a bare ship. The ship owners have the minimum responsibility. In the bare boat charter, the ship owners have the minimum responsibility. Charterers in this case become the disponent owner of the ship. The person who takes the ship on charter, he or she becomes disponent owner of the ship. He or she is responsible for manning as well as operating the ship. That means whatever way he or she wanted to operate the ship, manning the ship, they can operate or man in the way they wanted to do that. They have the right to appoint the master and chief engineer subject to the approval of the owners. They can appoint master, they can appoint crew member, they can appoint chief engineers, but this appointment should be subject to the approval of the owners. They bear all costs and expenses for the operation of ship, and they bear all the costs for the expenses and operation of the ship. Now the second part is your pre-shipment inspection. Once you have already hired the ship, now the question is about the quality control. See, for this purpose, in India, you have Export Inspection Council. The major function of the Export Inspection Council is to formulate and supervise the inspection schemes with the help of export inspection agencies. What happens? There are several export inspection agencies and Export Inspection Council. They formulate, they supervise, and they inspect the scheme of the quality or the procedure of the quality. They ensure it through the help of Export Inspection Agency. There are major three methods of quality control or quality assurance in India. First is your consignment wise inspection. In the consignment wise inspection, what happens? Each and every export consignment is subjected to a detailed inspection. That means whatever consignment you are sending, each and every consignment must be inspected by the Export Inspection Agency. Next is, the exporter has to apply to the Export Inspection Agency. In order to get the goods inspected, the exporter applies to the Export Inspection Agency and the document is notice of information. That is, on the notice of information you are applying to the Export Inspection Agency, and here you also submit cross-check or demand draft for inspection fee. Whatever is the prescribed inspection fee, for that you need to enclose the cross-check or demand draft, and you need to enclose the copy of the commercial invoice, you need to enclose copy of export contract and importer's technical specifications. See what happens whenever you are exporting the things, the machinery or whatever, the importers, they send you the specifications. So based on that specification, you are supposed to manufacture the goods. Therefore, here you need to provide importers technical specification for the purpose of quality control. Then, once you apply it to the Export Inspection Agency, Export Inspection Agency appoints an inspector for this purpose, for the visiting your place and ensuring the quality. Now the second is process is known as in-process quality control. In the in-process quality control, what happens? The export unit is approved as export worthy unit. So first you need to get approval as an export worthy unit. In this case, the agency will issue certificate of inspection on the declaration by the unit. Once the unit is declared, then the agency issues certificate of inspection. And for obtaining the inspection certificate, the exporter submit the following documents. These documents are application, that is notice of intimation, cross-check or demand draft for fee, commercial invoice, and again importer's technical specifications. On receipt of this document, the agency will issue inspection certificate. Next is your self-certification. For the self, you can also certify your goods or commodities about the quality of the goods or commodities. But for this purpose, there are prescribed norms. If you fulfill the prescribed norms, then you are allowed to self-certify your goods for the quality. But prescribed norms are norms related to product quality, design and development, raw material or bought out components, organization and personnel for quality control, process control, laboratory, quality audit, packaging, after sales services, housekeeping and maintenance. Detail of all these things as prescribed by the norms, if you fulfill all the prescription, you may be allowed to go for the self-certification of quality of your product. Now next is ISO 9000 series. It is ISO 9000 series. It is basically of international standards for quality systems, and they provide models for quality assurance in designing, developing, producing, installing, and service. The benefits of ISO 9000 series are better product design, improved product quality, reduction in scrap network, efficient utilization of men, machines, and materials, elimination of bottlenecks in production, creation of quality awareness, improvement of confidence among customers, improvement of company's image. Now, once you ensure that quality of products is your worth exporting, then now second aspect comes, sending the goods to the port for the approval, for the shipment. So for this purpose, you appoint an agent which is known as clearing and forwarding agent. Now let us analyze the role of clearing and forwarding agent. Clearing and forwarding agents works as a link between the owner of goods and owners of means of transport. For example, there is a ship and there is the owner of the goods. So the clearing and forwarding agents, they work as a link between both the, that is owner of the ship and owner of the goods. Advising exporters on trade laws. What happens, clearing and forwarding agent, they advise the exporters regarding the trade laws. For example, if there is a problem, which law may be applicable, or what may be the problems, or how those problems may be solved, under what laws that problems may be dealt, so on and so forth. Providing transport and handling cost information. They provide you information that how the transport would cost, how much the transport would cost you, how much the handling would cost you, how much the loading unloading would cost you, so on and so forth. Packing, marking and labeling. As you know that these days, packing, marking, labeling have become very, very important area. There is an Indian Institute of Packaging at Mumbai which provides 2-year courses on that. So it is a very, very advanced sort of the thing. So you need suggestions, you need the consultancy for this purpose. Arranging transport, they arrange transport to you. Completing customs and port formality. There are a whole range of customs and port formalities which are being completed by them. Preparing and procuring document. They prepare document, they process document, they procure documents also. Educating exporters on development in transports. Now there are customs. Second part is the customs clearance of export cargo. The basic objectives are nothing should go out of the country against the law, to ensure authenticity of the value, to assess and realize export duty, to check all the relevant regulatory provisions, and to provide export data. Now the stages of customs clearance are checking off of documents, verification of quantity and value of goods, verification and determination of rate of duty, direction for physical examination of goods, physical examination of goods, supervision of loading by the customs preventive officer, post-shipment endorsement by the customs preventive officer. And documents are shipping bill. As you know, there are 4 types of shipping bill: dutiable, drawback, free, and ex-form. Then what happens at the customs? You have customs appraiser and examiner, which provides you. Appraiser, examiner would carry out physical examination of the goods, and they put you the let export. Then there are customs preventive officer. When customs preventive officer are satisfied, then they put the stamp of let ship. After putting the stamp of the let ship, the goods are put on the boat, and the master of the carrier gives you a certificate known as men's mates receipts. Thank you.
Well, student, I think it has been the most informative lecture, most informative presentation on shipment of export cargo, and I do hope that the presentation which Professor Naval Kishore has delivered today might have updated the knowledge of the students, and the students might have tasted this lecture in a right spirit, in a right way, and I am sure that their knowledge has enhanced like anything. So I thanks Professor Naval Kishore for making this presentation so simple, and the student have been benefited a lot by this presentation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sunil, and thank you, participants.